All right, we're joined now by the Commissioner for Information, River State, Dr. Austin Tam George. Dr. Austin, it's good to have you in the studio this morning.
Thanks for having me.
You're welcome.
Good morning. Yeah.
Now, let's have a basic understanding of how things run in River State. We've seen in the past elections, anytime there's election, the tension in River State between the main political parties is very different from the tensions, the regular political tensions in other parts of the country. Why is that situation in River State?
You know, Mike, one of the first things that we need to recognize, you know, as far as elections are concerned in River State, is what the governor says. The governor has made it repeatedly clear that, look, if you're coming to conduct free and fair elections, where the election has legitimacy, where it has integrity, and where the sovereignty of the people's choices will be respected, the government will support that. As long as you're here to conduct free and fair elections, we'll support that. But if you're coming to River State in order to gerrymander the process, in order to rig the process in favor of the APC, you're going to have a lot of problem, because we have 4.5 million people there. And what the people have made sure is that, look, if you're coming to conduct elections, we will respect the outcome so long as the process has integrity. But if you're coming to gerrymander the process, you're going to have a lot of problem. Remember that, you know, sometime, you know, in March, we had a rerun election. We had a very unfortunate situation where, you know, the former governor of the state, you know, Mr. Rotimi Amaechi, you know, brought thousands of soldiers, thousands of police people. Actually, we don't mind the police presence, because this ultimately is a civil process. Mike, there is a Supreme Court judgment that manifestly forbids the military from getting involved in the electoral process. But he brought a lot of military people, you know, created a climate of siege. And that's what we are seeing. The people are willing to make their choices, but will those choices be respected? I think that's where we have the contention.
If we agree with what you're saying, are you saying two wrongs can make a right?
No. What we are saying is, you know, let the people be allowed to make their choices. Whatever the outcome, the government is going to accept them. The people themselves will accept the outcome. But the situation where a serving cabinet minister, you know, threatens, you know, to militarize what is manifestly, you know, a civil process. You know, you create this kind of crisis. You create this kind of crisis of confidence in the process.
We've not had such threat and such statement coming from that.
What we've seen over the past few days has been a tendency towards violence, because, you know, we've seen, the office, the INEC office in Ogoni, burnt by people who are suspected, you know, to be supporters of the other party, because the governor has made it very clear that, look, we will make sure that we allow a process that will respect the choices of the people. So why would you want to burn down the structures of an organization that is supposed to be conducting a free and fair process?
All right. Now, in a political process, we often hear where this political party accuses the other one and the other one accuses this one, as the case may be. But if you say that the members of the other political party carried out, has there been evidence, has there been verified evidence of the fact that
those who carried out
the bombing or the burning down of offices were from this political, or supporters of certain political,
you know, a lot of the politicians in River State, especially on the other side, they tend to have a pedigree of violence. I mean, look at Senator Magnus Abe, who has been in the Senate and now is seeking re-election. You know, you want a vision concerning how representation in River State, of River State in the Senate will be. Make the case to the electorate. Make the case to the voters themselves. But a situation where you are moving from one local government to the other with the military, terrorizing people, instigating violence, you know, ramping up this kind of violent rhetoric, you know, that basically creates the kind of conditions that leads to this kind of violence. You know, you might be thinking that you're campaigning, you might be thinking that you're playing politics, but the people who are on the ground, you know, might take advantage of the kind of violent rhetoric that they're hearing, and try to orchestrate the kind of violence we've seen.
I went with the reactions coming from independent observers, coming from civil society groups asking for investigations to be carried out, killings that are allegedly affiliated or coming from your quarter, from PDP and from Governor Wike's quarters itself. These are independent observers. These are not members of any party.
Yes, we are calling for an independent investigation. We are suggesting, you know, that let people come and investigate those who are responsible for the burning of that place. You know what? When I went with the governor to the scene, to the structure that was burnt, what he said was very significant. He said, "Look, first of all, we will rebuild this place from Monday. From today, we will rebuild this place from Monday. Pending the rebuilding of the place, we are going to give you an alternative building." We will give INEC an alternative building to use to conduct the elections. Now, if the governor was responsible, if the PDP was responsible, why would you burn down a building and then rebuild it and then give an alternative structure? So the point is that if you go to River State now, the PDP candidates are campaigning frenetically everywhere in every local government. Until I left Port Harcourt last night, the only party that isn't campaigning at all is the other party, the APC.
Oh, I know.
So, well, you know, apparently, you know, what we are hearing is that they've been holding all kinds of nocturnal meetings, you know, with the INEC officials in Abuja. They are trying to make sure, you know, that the results are written well in advance of the elections, you know, themselves. And this is a very dangerous precedent because in River State, people will not allow an outcome that is predetermined even before the elections themselves. So what we will suggest, what we are insisting upon is let the people make the choices. So long as the election is free and fair, then the process has integrity, we will accept the outcome. River State is a very vital state, you know, for the development of the country, and we wouldn't want a situation that will orchestrate violence and that will then snowball outside of River State. Let the people make the choices. So long as the process is free and fair, we are going to accept
the outcome. Except, of course, you already have a preemptive mind as it is. You already have a polluted mind, and that of course will rub off on the people.
No, what we are insisting upon, you know, Bosola, is to make sure that, look, let the people make their choices. There are a range of political parties. These parties have competing visions on how the state should be represented across the board. Now, if you make a strong case and the people vote you, so long as the process is free and fair, we are going to accept that.
Okay, we'll come to this. Let's hear the there's a word from on the allegation of nocturnal meetings and all of that. Let's hear the APC chieftain make reactions on this issue.
I can't remember any elections in the recent past where the PDP did not raise such empty alarms. They even raised it during the last run election. So it was mayor crying wolf, you know, and it's part of their strategy. They may have, when they do that, you better watch them because they're up to something.
There you go.
All right.
What are you up to?
From what he has said there, he said this is the recurring decimal where when the elections come, there's always a cry from the other side. It's not in our place to say they are empty or they are full, as the case may be, but you are there on ground. What do you have to say about that?
You know, what we would prefer is for the Independent Electoral Commission to be manifestly independent. That hasn't happened yet. Just last week, you know, officials of INEC had a secret meeting with members of the and chieftains of the APC, the River State APC. They denied it at first, but later, you know, the spokesperson of the INEC has admitted that these meetings were actually held, but they were routine meetings. But you see, in order to allow a transparent process and not to allow this kind of suspicions, what we would expect the INEC to do would be to say, look, if the APC chieftains are coming to meet INEC, we are ready to meet you, but it has to be in the presence of other parties, so that there will be no basis for suspicions. But the situation where you are having this kind of meetings, and then the governor, our governor gets intelligence that says that, look, INEC is meeting separately, not together with other stakeholders in the process, but separately with the APC, it raises this kind of suspicions. And so what we want is for the INEC to be manifestly transparent and independent.
How will they show that, apart from this meeting you just alluded to now, what else can INEC do to prove that they are unbiased in this case?
Well, what they can do is to make sure those, for instance, the electoral officers that are recruited to organize the process should be totally independent persons. What we found, if we're counting down to not just this election, but even the March election, and the governor Wike made it very clear that, look, those people that are now, you know, populating, you know, the INEC electoral officers list are card-carrying fanatical members of the APC. Why do you recruit people who are already interested in the electoral process? Why don't you get people who are, not partisan, those who are not involved in this process, to, you know, be the ones to superintend the process? But what we want INEC to do is to make sure that all those who are going to be part of the electoral process are completely independent. That's one. The second point is we want to make sure that all the documentation that will be needed during the electoral process are security vetted documents. Because what we found, you know, on the 19th of March, you know, was that a lot of the materials didn't have uniform security codes. Some had, some didn't have. Now the point is, in a very contentious, you know, political environment such as we have in Rivers State, you would want every process to be above board. You have documentation. Some have had security codes, some didn't have. You know, so we want to make sure that those who are conducting these elections, you know, the INEC officials, all their personnel are independent individuals, and all those who are handling processes, who are handling the documentation, are using documents that have security codes, so that we enter this process, you know, knowing that it's been above board and above suspicion.
All right. Now, from this standpoint where we are now, from your perception and from the allegations from some quarters, as the case may be, do you trust INEC to conduct a free and fair election in Rivers State?
You see, I would want to trust INEC. The Rivers State government will want to trust INEC. But you know, Mike, you know, trust is not something you call for. Trust is not something you toss at somebody walking down the street. Trust is something that has got to be earned. You know, you find that the INEC that we have now has, I'm sorry to say, failed in all respects. For instance, you know, you continue a pattern of inconclusive elections. I mean, look at the election in Imo State just a few days ago, yesterday. A lot of these elections are coming across to Nigerians as inconclusive. Now, when an independent electoral commission cannot put its acts together, we saw that in Kogi State, we've seen that across the country. And just yesterday also, you know, on Saturday, we saw elections that continue a pattern of inconclusiveness. So we suspect both the objectivity, the independence of INEC, and in fact, the capacity of INEC itself to conduct credible electoral processes.
All right, let's talk about the peace accord. Let's go into that. The APC chieftain we had just a couple of minutes ago alluded to that. Your party said that APC didn't sign the peace accord. And can you confirm that? And at the nitty-gritty of the peace accord itself, can you tell us about that?
No, I mean, the peace accord simply recommits, you know, all the stakeholders in the electoral process to have a peaceful, violence-free electoral process. I mean, for whatever it is worth, you know, you want all parties to make this kind of public commitment, because once you have this kind of commitment, it becomes a kind of social contract between all the stakeholders, so that nobody goes above board, nobody uses rhetoric that appeals to base instincts of supporters. So if you commit to this kind of if you publicly commit to this kind of peace accord, the tendency is that all the behavior of individuals in the, who are part of this process will be guided by the accord, even if for symbolic purposes. But as you saw, you know, the APC didn't sign on, because apparently
we didn't see that.
You know, well, you know, the spokesperson of the APC said, you know, they were not interested in those kind of accords. But you see, beyond symbolic purposes, the importance of those kind of accords, as I said earlier, is that, you know, people and groups basically commit to certain patterns of behavior, and they try to be held accountable, you know, whenever they go beyond those kind of things. But, you know,
but did that held water during the march? Because you signed the peace accord.
We signed the peace accord,
and there were infractions.
Yes, because
follow the peace accord itself. So were there persecutions?
Yes.
Based on the peace accord?
Yes, but because the former governor made a public statement that he was going to, quote, flood River State with security personnel, including soldiers. In fact, he was going from street to street, Mr. Rotimi Amaechi. Was going from street to street in Port Harcourt with over 500 soldiers, fully armed, you know, in a simple legislative election. So they did not only sign it, they violated the very spirit of the accord they themselves signed. And our own contention from the beginning has been, look, why don't you simply allow the Rivers people to make free choices about those who will represent them? Why do you want to make sure that these elections are rigged well in advance? Why are you injecting the military into a civil electoral process? Even when there is a Supreme Court judgment forbidding, manifestly forbidding the military from getting involved in a civil process such as this.
All right, now let's get to let's go back to INEC now. The point there is, one way or the other, elections were suspended and all of that. Going into the election now, how prepared is INEC from the standpoint of an umpire to conduct this election?
I think that only INEC can answer the question. If you are talking about, you know, the general operational climate, the River State Governor has made it very clear, Governor Wike has made it very clear. If you want to conduct free and fair electoral process, this government will support you. We will make sure, you know, that we work with INEC and all stakeholders to make sure that these elections are peaceful. I mean, we are in government already, and so we serve everyone, including those who are members of the APC, those who are in the PDP, and all other partisan individuals, including, by the way, those who are not involved in partisan politics, because we have a responsibility to administer the state. The governor has been adamant that, look, we will allow a free and fair electoral process. Is INEC itself independent? Only INEC can answer the question. Are they ready to conduct free and fair electoral process that has integrity? Only INEC can answer that. What we've seen, it's an unfortunate pattern of inconclusiveness, and I suspect it is because INEC has lost its independence. I mean, why would INEC officials hold secret nocturnal meetings with members of a particular party that are interested in an election that is only 1 week away?
But INEC came out to say that there wasn't any election, there wasn't any meetings. In such a
But Nick Dazang, the spokesperson of the INEC, after a series of denials, eventually admitted that the meetings in fact took place, but that they were routine meetings. Now, I'm not faulting the meetings particularly, I mean, because INEC is at liberty to have those kind of meetings with stakeholders. But for the sake of transparency and to rise above, you know, suspicion, I think what they should do is to make sure that anytime they are holding this kind of interface with stakeholders, let all other parties be present so that you are seen to be truly independent and above suspicion.
Okay, let's talk about the security aspect of the rerun yeah. going on in River State. There were allegations about some police members, police officers being culpable in the last the March election that you held. What's the guarantee? Do you have confidence in the Nigerian police now that such infractions won't take place again?
You know, Pusolani, one of the first things we need to recognize about security generally, not just in respect of elections, but generally in the state, is that Governor Wike was the first governor within 3 months, within the first 100 days in office, to provide, you know, over 100 security-fitted vehicles to the police and the joint security forces. He continues to give financial and logistical support to the police and the military. He supports them to the point of buying diesel and petrols, you know, for their vehicles. He continues to give them extensive financial support. In fact, you know, arrears of, you know, allowances that were due to the military and to the security forces, you know, that were not paid by the previous administration, as soon as he arrived on the scene, he cleared them. No governor, as far as this current political dispensation is concerned, has given as much financial and logistical support to the police and the joint security forces as Governor Wike has done.
So you expect that should be a justification for the police to work for you?
Yes, we expect that this is ultimately a civil process, people simply making choices, you know, between parties and candidates, those who will represent them. This is a simple civil process. And this is something that the police ought to be able to pretend. You see, but a situation where the police themselves, you know, are seen to be manipulated by political office holders, it gives us a great deal of concern. For instance, no other governor has had to work with as many as five police commissioners, as our governor has done.
We'll come back to this. We're going out on TVC Entertainment, but viewers there can continue with TVC Breakfast on TVC Nigeria, on Kansat Channel 190, DSTV 418, GoTV 45.
And ACTV, it is 510, so get the remote and let's continue the conversation there.
Right, thanks for staying with us on TVC Breakfast. We are discussing the proposed rerun elections in Rivers State, and we have in the studio Dr. Austin Tam George. He's the Commissioner of Information, Rivers State. And joining us now on phone is the INEC Commissioner in Rivers State, Anyedi Ikoyiwak. Anyedi, it's good to have you on TVC Breakfast right now. Can you give us a background to the preparation towards the rerun election in Rivers State coming on Saturday?
Well, I think that when we talk about preparation, we must have in our mind what made the election inconclusive. We all know that the reason for inability to conclude the election in Rivers State was as a result of violence. And part of the preparation was for us to meet with stakeholders to agree that there will be a conducive environment for the conduct of elections. We can all agree that today the environment in Rivers State is not still conducive.
By not being conducive, what exactly are you talking about?
A few days ago, our office was set ablaze, and all the non-sensitive materials destroyed. This is enough distraction from our preparation.
So you don't feel secure? Do you feel secure that the election can go ahead? Are you confident? Are you secured enough to conduct the election there?
What I am saying is that the election was put off as a result of violence, and this violence is still going on. So the commission is looking at the environment to now make a pronouncement on the election.
So there's a possibility that the election may not hold. Mr. Ikoyiwak, let's cut to the chase here and let's for clarification. You're saying the environment is not conducive yet. You're looking at the environment to make a pronouncement. So there's a possibility that the election may not hold.
I am saying that we must know the reason why this election was not concluded. The major reason was violence. And in continuing this election, there was need for people, for all stakeholders to agree that the environment will be made conducive. And as of now, we can all agree that the environment is not yet conducive for a conduct of election. And the recent burning of our office is enough distractions from our preparation.
So I want a yes or no answer, Mr. Ikoyiwak. Sorry for interrupting you. Mr. Ikoyiwak, sorry for interrupting you. I want a yes or no answer now. There's a possibility that if the environment is as tense as it is, according to you, that the election may not hold. Yes or no, please?
I don't answer yes or no. I am explaining the environment. That we cannot have a free, fair, credible election in an environment of violence. This is one thing that has to be in the back of our mind. In our process of preparing for the elections, we must also observe whether the environment will be conducive for elections. We are talking about lives of people. We are talking about material. We are talking about a situation where people will have to go out there with their mind, with a free mind to either vote or conduct elections. So we will take the environment into consideration in actually arriving at whether the election will hold on that day or not. We will need advice, security advice, and other things. So okay. This is what I am trying to say.
All right, and there were allegations by, in fact, the governor at the time made an allegation that INEC was holding nocturnal meeting with the All Progressives Congress. Can you give us a light in that regard?
I don't know anything about that. INEC is an independent body, and it has no right to hold. When we hold meetings, it's an open meeting for all political parties and all stakeholders. And those meetings are always made open, and the media are always there to cover. So we cannot be holding nocturnal meetings with anybody and so on. So I don't want to join issues with all those things, because a lot of people have said so many things. So there is no point joining issues. What I like is try to focus on how to conduct elections, especially in an environment like Rivers.
But the Commissioner of Information in River State is here with us in the studio, and he just made allegations, and he actually quoted the PRO of INEC in Abuja affirming that there was such a meeting in River State. Are you saying the national INEC went ahead your head and held the meeting? Is that why you didn't know about it?
He said there was a meeting in Abuja. I'm not in Abuja, I'm in River State. I have stated my position that there have never been any meeting, as far as I am concerned. Every meeting that we have held has been stakeholders meeting, meeting of consolidation, and it's always been with all the political parties and political stakeholders.
All right. From your standpoint, you have been on ground monitoring, being the umpire generally. What generally is wrong with, or what gives rise to the kind of violence we have or we find or see in River State during elections, from your standpoint?
That is one of the questions you should even ask the commissioner, who is there with you.
I want your own explanation. I want your own perception. I want your own observation.
Well, the observation is that the environment is as conducive as it should be. I will take it into consideration the burning of Kana office. Was it an election day? So let us at an office in the state of preparedness, an office was burned down completely. All the non-sensitive materials burned. Was it on election day that you would say they burned it out of annoyance or out of anything? This one is that an office was just standing and somebody said it at press. And you are talking about the environment. And if I am not drawing attention to a hazard situation.
All right.
Thank you very much, Aniedi.
Thank you. Welcome.
Right. Okay.
So we still have with us in the studio Austin Tam George, who is the Commissioner for Information, River State. So really, the question is now to you. You attempted to answer it, but now can we be more? What is responsible for violence?
River State is safe. River State is safe for any kind of activity. Don't forget that this is the state where we have 4.5 million people. This is the state where we have the largest concentration of oil companies. This is a state where the Eleme Petrochemicals, Indorama, has invested $1.5 billion, has a lot of business. All kinds of things are happening there. How can it be that it is only when elections are about to hold that we hear all of a sudden that this place is no longer conducive for elections? Look, we have a very vibrant population. All kinds of things are happening in River State. On the positive note, we do not have a security crisis. As I was saying, except of course,
even before the announcement of this rerun of the rerun, there are court cases. There are issue of
those court cases. The police have determined that a lot of these so-called court clashes, were in fact sponsored by the APC.
It was so bad that even President Buhari calls it. It is primitive. Quoting President Buhari. Concerning the court killings in River State, that it is primitive, barbaric, and unacceptable. Really?
Well, you know, we totally reject those kind of characterization. River State remains safe. We have businesses thriving there. When Governor Wike came into office, our internally generated revenue used to be 5 billion naira every month. As I speak, because we are getting more and more investors in the state, our internally generated revenue is moving from 5 billion to 7 billion to 9 billion. That doesn't indicate the situation of a state that is in crisis. The situation, in fact, is such that people are coming there for more and more businesses. What we have found is that the APC is perhaps, you know, responsible for a lot of these call clashes, because we have members of the APC who are facing multiple charges of murder. Right there in River State, they're in police custody. A lot of the people that have been killed in court clashes, the APC itself has publicly claimed these dead bodies as their members. So that has given the police a great deal of thought. Does it mean that we are no longer dealing with conventional criminal cases? Are we dealing with politically motivated court clashes also by the APC?
Let me come in here. You're saying the APC has agreed or came to make claims of some of those dead bodies. Is it that there were no cult members from the PDP, as the case may be?
What we, you know, the governor that I work with night and day has made it very clear, both in the public and even in closed doors executive council meetings. We do not support violence. Anybody who is a member of the PDP and claims to be working for the government is part of a violent process. The law is going to take its course. The governor has completely denounced violence. He has led right from the front to demolish the homes. I'm sure you've seen images in the media. The homes of suspected criminal elements in the state. The governor continues to support. No governor works with the security forces as much as he does. What we have seen is that anywhere there are call clashes and people are arrested, or, you know, somehow, you know, we are gunned down by other cult members, the APC surprisingly has come out to say, look, these people, we are our members. Even those who are standing trials now, the APC is, you know, orchestrating a process where the appeals, you know, for their bail conditions will no longer be heard by conventional appeal process. They've set up a separate appeal process all the way from Abuja to hear the appeals
Any PDP member
who is involved in any kind of violent process is completely on his own, and the governor has made it very clear in public. You do not work for us. We cannot work for you. The government has a blueprint for development. How can you possibly implement the blueprint for development of the state in a climate of crisis? All right. The governor has totally denounced violence.
In all of this violent and cult killings, and as the case may be, what has the governor done to ensure that there is no violence in this state?
The governor has made sure, as I said, that he continues to support the police and the joint security forces. He has made sure that any person who is involved in criminality will be brought to book. You probably know that, you know, we now have an amnesty program that is specific to criminality in River State. Anybody who denounces crime, who forsakes his criminal ways and takes advantage of the amnesty window, will be rehabilitated. The governor has now put, you know, an amnesty program in place. But the window is very short. If they don't take advantage, you know, of the amnesty program and they continue in their criminal ways, all proceeds of criminality will be confiscated. And I'm sure you've seen images of the governor marching right in front with the security forces to demolish buildings and hideouts of criminal elements. So these are things that are very clear. He took a loan on behalf of the River State government. He took a loan of 2 billion naira from the central bank. And you know what he has done with it? 35,000 beneficiaries, 35,000 small and medium scale, you know, business owners have benefited from the scheme. The government has a very elaborate program for empowerment.
But
those who choose a life of criminality will have no hiding place in River State. The governor is very clear about
it. It's interesting you're enumerating the economic policies and the benefits that so far it's going on in River State. But perhaps APC has a grouse with the PDP convention held in River State. There's been allegations that you used that your governor used taxpayers' money to organize those conventions, cost the conventions.
No. Look, the PDP has its own self-financing mechanism. You know, the state governor doesn't have to sponsor, PDP conventions. They have their own, you know, structures of financing those kind of conventions. And so, you know, probably how the APC, continues to bake one propaganda message after the other from time to time. We have nothing to do with financially supporting any party. What we can do is to say, look, if you want to come here to host the convention, we are ready to be a happy host. But the PDP has its own internal.
What does that mean to be a happy host?
A happy host in the sense that it will give us an opportunity.
Using taxpayers' money?
No, it will give us an opportunity to showcase River State as a peaceful place. As I speak to you, all kinds of conventions are coming, are holding in River State. Tomorrow, I think today from 10 o'clock, the magistrates, Nigeria Magistrates Conference is holding in River State. We had the AMA Award. There has been no violence threatening any kind of business in River State, except, okay, when it has to do with elections and the APC and its chieftains are using the military, and cult members to instigate this kind of violence we are talking about.
Well, it's okay. We hear your allegations here and there. But however, the more than 20 states in Nigeria are owing salaries, and we hear River State is one of those. Can you give us a situation?
No, River State is not owing salaries. Look at what we've done. We inherited pension arrears that Mr. Rotimi Amaechi refused to pay pensioners for 6 months. We inherited that. The governor has cleared that. We had 3 months of unpaid salaries to thousands of civil servants. Rotimi Amaechi refused to pay. The governor Wike cleared that within 3 months of coming into office. 8 months of arrears, pension arrears for teachers, we are not paid by Rotimi Amaechi's administration. Governor Wike, has cleared that. What is happening in River State is that we had a BVN staff verification process.
Yes,
the BVN, as you know, Mike, is the bank verification number. And now the governor's argument was, look, if you can't conduct banking business without a BVN number, without a bank verification number, we will use the same BVN process to do staff vetting process right here in River State. And so what happened? 1 billion naira is now saved as a result of that vetting process.
So you're not owing salary?
Yes. Now I need to explain this. What he now did as a further staff vetting process was to say, look, why don't we put in place an advanced, even more advanced biometric process? Now what this means is that we've been able to capture more than 2,000 ghost workers, people who are taking salaries from as many as 6 points. And the governor is adamant, unless you're vetted by the biometric process, you will not be paid. We've seen situations where directors of finance, permanent secretaries implicated by this biometric process, instigating media campaigns against the government by saying, oh, you are owing workers. We are not owing a single worker. What we are
Let's talk about...
you have captured, you will not be paid. So those who have not been captured, understandably, has not
been
paid.
Let's talk about
in any case,
projects.
That biometric process is going to end at the end of this month. If there are if there are people who have not been captured and who eventually get captured in the course of this week, the salaries will be cleared. But you will not be paid except you've been biometric.
Okay, will you continue the rail project started by former Governor Rotimi Amaechi?
No, that is an ill-fated, ill-conceived project. Over 45 billion naira was spent. You need to come. I'm going to invite you, Mike, to come to Azikiwe Road in Port Harcourt to see, the extent, mind-boggling extent of financial recklessness by the Rotimi Amaechi administration. 45 billion naira was spent on the monorail project. That monorail project leads to nowhere. In fact, if it proceeds from where it is, it means thousands of houses will have to be blown down. Money was spent on a project that has no use for whatsoever. And so when we called engineers, all kinds of experts, they were alarmed, in fact, that this kind of process, project could in fact be put in place, 45 billion naira down the drain. That is just one. I mentioned the 2 billion naira that Governor Wike took from the central bank, and now there are about 35,000 beneficiaries. You know what happened in 2004? The Rotimi Amaechi administration took 4 billion naira from the same CBN. They called it the agricultural loan. They were going to give to thousands of farmers in River State. As I speak here, as I sit here, Mike, not a single beneficiary in River State. The money was simply used to fund APC activities and to sponsor the elections of
president. Those are allegations.
Anyway, we await the verification and evidence of all of that. But
yes.
However, Dr. Austin Tam George, River State Commissioner for Information, thank you very much for coming on the program.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you for coming.
And we also thank INEC Commissioner Aniedi Kelwak for joining us earlier on the program. Thank you.